You just bought a coffee with your Visa card. That transaction felt instant, right? A simple tap, a beep, and the coffee's yours. For years, this seamless experience has made Visa the undisputed king of payments, a global titan processing thousands of transactions every single second. But what if I told you that the technology behind that tap is basically an illusion? What if I told you that behind the curtain, that simple coffee purchase kicks off a clunky, expensive, and days-long process that feels more like it's from the 1970s than today? For decades, we've all just accepted this system because, honestly, what was the alternative? Visa built a powerful closed empire, and we're all living in it. But its reign might be ending sooner than you think. A new system is being built, quietly, layer by layer. A system that's open to everyone, impossibly cheap, and genuinely instant. A system that could make today's biggest payment networks look like ancient relics. This isn't just about a new competitor or a flashy app. This is a fundamental shift in the rules of the game, one that promises to do for money what the internet did for information. And the technology at the heart of this revolution, it's Bitcoin. To understand why a giant like Visa is on borrowed time, you have to appreciate the sheer scale of its dominance. And let's be fair, it's a masterpiece of centralized engineering. VisaNet, the company's global network, connects tens of millions of merchants and thousands of banks across more than 200 countries. It boasts the capacity to handle over 24,000 transaction messages per second, a fire hose of financial data. When you tap your card, you're plugging into this massive web. It feels powerful, it feels efficient, but it's an illusion, a very clever, very well-marketed illusion. Let's break down that coffee purchase. When you tap your card, money doesn't magically fly from your bank to the coffee shop's bank. Not even close. Instead, a message zips through a chain of middlemen, the shop's terminal, their bank, the Visa network, and finally your bank. Your bank gives a quick, yep, they're good for it, and sends an approval message back down the line. This all happens in a flash. This is the authorization. It's a promise of payment. But the key word here is promise. The money hasn't actually moved. The actual moving of money happens later through a process called clearing and settlement. At the end of the day, the coffee shop bundles all its Visa transactions and sends them off. These batches work their way through the system, and finally, sometimes a day or even a few business days later, the actual funds are transferred. The coffee shop, which gave you a real product in good faith, has to wait to get its money. This delay creates huge cash flow headaches for millions of businesses. It's a global system built on IOUS, running on a timeline that's completely out of sync with our instant world. And for the privilege of running this delayed IOU-based system, everyone pays a hidden tax. Every time a card is used, the merchant pays a fee, typically somewhere between 1.5% and 3.5%. That might not sound like much, but it's a constant drain on businesses. That small cafe, that local bookstore, they all give up a slice of their revenue to this private toll road. And guess who ultimately pays that fee? You do. The cost is baked right into the price of everything you buy. It's a multi-billion dollar tax on the global economy, all for using a closed proprietary system. And that's the final nail in the coffin for the old model. It's a walled garden. The Visa network is centralized and permissioned. You can't just build a new, cool payment app on top of Visa's rails without their explicit approval and a business deal. It's not a public park, it's a private club. This means innovation only happens at the speed Visa allows, and only in ways that benefit Visa's bottom line. For decades, this was the only way to operate at a global scale. But the world has changed. We now have a blueprint for building global open networks. We call it the internet. And now we have a protocol to do the same thing for money. So, how could anyone possibly build a challenger to the Visa monolith? It starts by completely reframing what Bitcoin actually is. For years, critics loved to point out that Bitcoin had failed as digital cash. They'd laugh and say, how can this be the future when it can only handle about 7 transactions per second globally? They'd scoff at the 10-minute average wait for a block of transactions to be confirmed. Compared to Visa's 24,000 transactions per second, it seems ridiculous. And here's the thing, in that narrow sense, the critics are absolutely right. Trying to compare Bitcoin's base layer to Visa is like comparing a giant cargo ship to a Ferrari and declaring the ship a failure because it's slow. They're built for two totally different jobs. Bitcoin slowness isn't a bug, it's its most important feature. It's the price you pay for what it was truly designed to do, be incredibly decentralized and secure. Think of it like this, a system can be decentralized, secure, and scalable, but you can only ever really max out two of those three. The genius of Bitcoin's creator was the deliberate choice to sacrifice speed on the base layer to achieve a level of security and decentralization the world had never seen before. Why was that so critical? Because Bitcoin wasn't built to be another payment app. It was built to be a new global settlement layer. It's a system for moving value with absolute finality, without asking a bank or any other middleman for permission. When a Bitcoin transaction is confirmed on the blockchain, it is, for all practical purposes, irreversible. It is settled. This is something Visa just doesn't do. Visa provides authorization, a promise to settle later. Bitcoin provides final settlement. A much better analogy for Bitcoin's base layer isn't Visa, but something like FedWire, the system banks use to send huge sums of money to each other. Those systems aren't fast in the consumer sense, and you'd never use them to buy a coffee. They're for large, important transfers where certainty is everything. Bitcoin is the first global, permissionless, and decentralized version of that. It's a neutral foundation for money that anyone can use. For years, all we had was this incredibly secure but slow base layer, and the world correctly pointed out that it wasn't ready for primetime payments. The mistake was thinking that was the end of the story. It was just the beginning. The internet's base protocols weren't built to handle Netflix, and Bitcoin's base layer wasn't built to handle a billion coffee sales. The solution for the internet was to build new layers on top, and the solution for Bitcoin is exactly the same. The story of how the internet grew up is the perfect roadmap for Bitcoin. The internet's core protocol, TCP/IP, is just a simple, robust way to send packets of data. It has no idea what a web page or an email is. To get that, we built new layers on top, HTTP for the web, SMTP for email. This layered approach unleashed a wave of innovation without messing with the secure foundation. This is exactly what's happening with Bitcoin. We have the secure settlement layer, the digital bedrock. Now, developers are building layer 2 protocols on top of it for fast, high-volume payments. The most famous one is the Lightning Network, and understanding Lightning is the aha moment where the whole Bitcoin versus Visa argument gets flipped on its head. The Lightning Network is a protocol for fast, cheap Bitcoin payments. So, how does it work? The easiest way to think about it is like a bar tab. Imagine you and your friend are at a bar. Instead of swiping your card for every single drink, you open a tab. You buy a round, the bartender makes a note. Your friend gets the next one, another note. You can do this all night, racking up dozens of transactions on the tab. At the end of the night, you settle up once. All those individual drink orders happened instantly off-chain on the bartender's notepad. The only on-chain transaction was the final bill. The Lightning Network is similar. Two people can open a payment channel on the main Bitcoin blockchain. Once that channel is open, they can send Bitcoin back and forth between each other an almost unlimited number of times instantly and for fractions of a penny. These are real Bitcoin transactions, but they happen off-chain just between the two of them. When they're done, they close the channel and the final balance is recorded as a single transaction on the main blockchain for final settlement. But here's where it gets crazy powerful. You don't need a direct channel with everyone. If Alice has a channel with Bob and Bob has a channel with Carol, Alice can pay Carol through Bob. The network finds the cheapest, fastest route automatically. This creates a true network effect. Look at what this solves. Speed. Lightning transactions aren't limited by Bitcoin's 10-minute block time. They happen in milliseconds. Truly instant. Cost. The fees are microscopic, often just a tiny fraction of a cent. This is worlds cheaper than Visa's percentage-based fees. Scalability. While the base layer is limited, the Lightning Network can theoretically process millions of transactions per second, putting it in the same league as traditional payment giants. In practice, that number depends on the network's structure, but the potential is there. And this isn't some far-off dream. The Lightning Network is live and growing fast. As we look at 2025, the adoption trends are undeniable. Reports suggest some enterprise wallets are seeing nearly all their Bitcoin transactions shift to Lightning. Major exchanges like Coinbase have integrated it, with some reporting that around 15% of their Bitcoin withdrawals are now happening on Lightning. Payment processors like CoinGate have seen the share of Bitcoin payments made via Lightning more than double in 2 years. Now accounting for over 16% of their Bitcoin orders. This thing is moving from a niche experiment to a real-world payment system, fast. CTA. If you're starting to see how this completely changes the game, make sure you're subscribed. We break down these tech shifts every week. Now let's talk about what this new world actually looks like. The ripple effects of a global, open, instant, and nearly free payment system are hard to overstate. This isn't about a slightly better Visa. It's about creating entirely new ways for us to interact with money. First, say goodbye to cross-border payment headaches. Today, sending money overseas is a slow, expensive mess of correspondent banks and crazy fees. With a global network like Lightning, there is no cross-border. A payment from a phone in Tokyo to a terminal in Toronto is just a native transaction, data flowing over the internet. The idea of a 3-5% foreign exchange fee will seem like a joke. Companies are already proving this, letting users send dollars that arrive as euros on the other side of the world almost instantly, using Bitcoin as the invisible settlement rail in between. Second, and maybe even more revolutionary, is the dawn of true micropayments. The old financial system just can't handle tiny payments. It doesn't make sense to charge a Visa card 5 cents because the fees would be more than the transaction itself. This has forced everything online into clunky subscription models. With Lightning, where fees are a fraction of a cent, you can suddenly stream money. Imagine reading an article and paying a hundredth of a cent for every paragraph, or listening to a podcast and streaming a few cents per minute directly to the creator with no platform taking a 30% cut. It goes even further, opening the door for a machine-to-machine economy. Your electric car could pay for its own charge by the kilowatt hour. Your browser could pay a tiny fee to websites for an ad-free experience. This isn't sci-fi. It's what happens when payments have no lower limit. Third, this offers a path to real financial inclusion. For years, we've heard about banking the unbanked, but the solutions usually just pull people into the same old permission system. Getting a Visa card requires a bank account, which requires an ID and a stable address, barriers for billions of people. Bitcoin and Lightning are permissionless. Anyone with a cheap smartphone and an internet connection can download a wallet and instantly connect to a global payment network. They can receive money from anywhere and hold it themselves without needing anyone's approval. And finally, think back to that coffee shop owner waiting days for their money. On the Lightning Network, that settlement is instant and final, at least for all practical purposes. The moment you pay, the money is in their wallet, ready to be used. For small businesses, turning cash flow from a days-long waiting game into a real-time stream is revolutionary. Okay, it's fair to be skeptical. If this is so great, what are the roadblocks? The elephant in the room has always been Bitcoin's price volatility. How can you use something for payments if its value swings so wildly? It's a valid concern, but the layered architecture is providing a solution here too. The answer lies in stablecoins. New protocols are being built on Bitcoin's layers that will allow for the creation of assets pegged to the US dollar or other currencies. While most stablecoins currently live on other blockchains like Ethereum, the ability to have a digital dollar that runs on the Lightning Network is the next frontier. You could get the price stability of the dollar with all the benefits of this new system: instant, global, low cost. It's the best of both worlds. Another argument is that this is all just too complicated. Payment channels, nodes, liquidity. And in the early days it was. But do you need to know how TCP/IP works to browse the web? Of course not. The complexity gets hidden by user-friendly apps. The same is happening with Lightning. Modern wallets make the experience seamless. You download an app, get some funds, and tap to pay. All the hard stuff happens in the background, but maybe the biggest sign of this shift comes from Visa itself. They are not ignoring this. Far from it. Visa has been aggressively exploring stablecoin settlement and integrating with blockchains for cross-border payments. You might see this and think, see, Visa will just adopt the tech and stay king. But that misses the point. Visa's moves are the ultimate validation of the technology. The giant is admitting that slow, batch-based systems are the past and blockchain rails are the future. They're trying to bolt this new tech onto their old centralized model. But can a for-profit company built on charging fees for private access truly lead an open, free-to-use protocol? History suggests the answer is no. This is the classic innovator's dilemma. Visa's crypto experiments aren't a sign of its strength. They're a sign that it knows its foundation is cracking. This brings us to the heart of the matter. This isn't a battle between two companies. It's a battle between a company and an open protocol. It's Visa versus TCP/IP for money. In the early days of the internet, companies like AOL and CompuServe built hugely profitable walled garden online services. They controlled everything, and for a while, they were dominant. But they were ultimately closed, proprietary tech. Meanwhile, the open protocols of the internet were there for anyone to build on. In the end, the open protocol always wins. The open web swallowed AOL. The same dynamic is about to play out for the world of value. Visa built a product you have to pay to use. Bitcoin is a standard anyone can adopt. The internet made sending information global, permissionless, and nearly free. Bitcoin's new layers are doing the exact same thing for sending value. So, is your Visa card obsolete? Not tomorrow. You'll almost certainly use it next week. Empires don't fall overnight. The habits are too ingrained, but the ground beneath our feet has already shifted. The bedrock for a new financial system has been laid, and the next layers are being built at a furious pace. The developers are building, adoption is growing, and even the old guard admits the underlying tech is the future. Your physical Visa card isn't obsolete yet, but the centralized, expensive, and slow system it represents, that is already a relic. The change is no longer a matter of if, but when. What do you think? Is Visa's empire destined to fall, or will it find a way to adapt and survive? Let me know your thoughts down in the comments. This is one of the biggest technological shifts of our lifetime, and we're watching it happen in real time. If you want to keep exploring the future of finance and technology, be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell. Thanks for watching.